टुडे वी विल टॉक अबाउट द पॉइंट सेट टोपोलॉजिकल एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ सिंपलीशियल कॉम्प्लेक्सेस। तो दिस इज द टॉपिक फॉर मॉड्यूल 31। बाय डेफिनेशन ऑल पॉलीहेड्रॉन्स being homeomorphic to simplicial complex, modulus of the geometric realization of the simplicial complex, right? They will share all the topological properties of that. And we have seen that in the very definition that the topology on mod K is finer than the metric topology induced on it by its inclusion in I power V of those functions which take only finitely many non-zero values. Anything which is finer than metric topology will have many, many other properties. One such thing is that it must be Hausdorff. Any space which is finer than a metric space is automatically Hausdorff because the metric space is Hausdorff. So the first theorem is obvious here. Mod K is Hausdorff. Okay. So the next proposition here is the key for several important properties of mod K. But this key is totally obvious from the definition. Namely, every mod K is actually disjoint union of all its open simplexes. Starts with zero simplexes. By definition, zero simplexes are open. Remember, a modulus of a simplex consists of functions which are non-zero at most at the vertices of the simplex with various properties. Summation should be zero and so on, right? And the open simplex consists of those which have precisely not equal to zero on that set, on the set F. Okay? Everywhere else it is zero. On that, on all the points here, the coordinates are non-zero, that is open simplex. The zero simplex, the modulus of a singleton, nothing but the function which takes one there and zero everywhere, everywhere else, on every other vertex. So automatically, singleton modulus of singleton is both, is an open simplex as well as closed simplex. So don't confuse it with open subsets and closed subsets. Okay. A closed simplex is a closed subset also, but open simplexes need not be open everywhere. If they are open inside closure of F, closed simplex F, that's all. But what I want here is that they are, the mod K is precisely equal to disjoint union of these open simplexes. Take any point here, it belongs to precisely one of them, namely its support. Look at the support, that's a simplex. Then open simplex of F4 contains the point, contains that function. And nothing else will contain it. Therefore, this is a disjoint union of these things. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Clear.
We will use this in a very, very subtle, very nice way. This lemma will use that one. Take any subset of K such that every simplex F of K, okay, has exactly one point in the interior of F from A. A intersection F has at most one point, sorry. The sum of them may not intersect. If they intersect, that point of intersection should be 1, and it should be the interior point of F, one of the interior points. Assume this. This is the condition on the subset A, not a condition on X mod K or F, okay? For each F, this should happen. A intersection F can be empty, or A intersection F is one singleton point. And that point must be the interior here. If that happens, A is a closed subset of K, and it is discrete. I hope you know what is a discrete subset of a topological space. So the proof is very straightforward. So we use the fact that mod K is disjoint in, you know, its open simplexes. Suppose this is true for A, the assumptions on A I have given. Now you take any subset of B, any subset B of A. That will also have the same property, right? It will have fewer points, and so that will have same property. A intersection B may be even empty also, but it cannot be more than one, because even A intersection F has one, so B intersection F will also at most one. Okay, the same property. In particular, what happens is, if you take the closure of F will have all the smaller open simplexes also. Namely, take any subset of F, proper subset of F, all of them will come. That's the union. Closure of F itself is a disjoint union of open simplexes. Namely, all these open simplexes are subsets of F now, including F. Therefore, there will be only finitely many of them. If this has only finitely many open simplex, each of them contributing at most one point, B intersection F will be a finite subset. Any finite subset of mod K is a closed set because K is Hausdorff. So B intersection F is closed subset of F for every mod F. Okay, but then we know that if this is the property of any subset, that B itself must be closed. Intersection with every mod F is closed in mod F means B itself is closed in mod K. Okay, so what we have proved is that every subset B of A, every subset B of A is a closed set. In particular, A is closed. And it must be discrete, because every subset is closed, every subset is open also. So it is a discrete. It's a discrete topological subspace as a subset of mod K, and it's closed. Okay, the topology induced from mod K on A is discrete. Okay, it's a discrete space. Every point is open in particular. All right. Now, this lemma was an easy consequence of the easiest observation here. So now we will derive some consequence of this lemma 5.3, which is quite completely not so obvious at all. Each mod F is compact, that is obvious, because we have seen that it is homeomorphic to a disk, right? But conversely, each compact subset of mod K is covered by finitely many open or closed simplexes. A closed simplex is a closed set. An open simplex is not an open set. It is not an open cover for mod K. So don't make that mistake. If you have a compact set covered by some open, has an open cover, then it has a finite subcover. That is not the point here. The point here is that these open sets are not at all open in mod K. Okay. Only maximal simplexes will have open simplexes open inside mod K. Yet, only finitely many of them will cover it. So this is the point. Okay. Once open simplexes are finitely many of them cover it, the closed simplexes will follow. Because you can take the closure also, so there will be finitely many of them, so they will cover it. Okay, so I am going to prove this. Finitely many open simplexes themselves will cover it. Okay, so how do I prove it? Well, mod K is homeomorphic to a closed disk that we have seen, so it is compact. Now I am going to prove something. Start with any compact set L contained inside mod K. Then we can construct a subset A of L such that L intersection open, take any open simplex, is non-empty, then it has only a singleton set. In other words, if it intersects, then I pick up one point from this one. Okay, L is given any compact set, okay, L, we are going to construct a subset A of L. Look at L intersection F. If it is non-empty, pick up one point from this F, mod F intersection F. So that, put it inside A. If it is empty, don't worry. Okay. So what is a subset A? A is subset of L. And for each open simplex, okay, L intersection F is non-empty, and I am picking that A intersection F is also one point or empty. Therefore, A has exactly the same property as in this lemma, previous lemma. Therefore, A is a discrete set. Therefore, being a subset of a compact set, a discrete set must be finite. What is the outcome? Look at, for each point in A, there is one and only one F, okay, which will intersect this one. Okay, but if you take all F, they will cover the whole of L. Therefore, there are only finitely many F1, F2, F1s like this, corresponding to elements in A, which will cover L. So the first part is over. Take closures here, so they will also cover L. So that will give you second part here. Okay. It is not true that closed simplexes which meet another closed simplex, they will be finitely in number. That is not true. Okay. You can take a point, and then there can be infinitely many edges which are incident at that point. That is allowed. Similarly, one single edge may be incident on several triangles, infinitely many triangles. Okay. Yeah. So, a simplex, you have taken his one statement, mod F is covered by mod F. So, why do you need so close simplexes? Right, but this part is very important. Every compact set is closed by this one, that is the whole thing. But mod F is covered by finitely many open simplexes. So I should have stated it maybe separately for these two things. For mod F is covered by mod F itself, one single simplex. What is the, that is not the beauty. The beauty for mod F is open, but the proof shows that every compact set is covered by finitely many closed sets, closed simplexes like this. Okay. The next thing is another important property in topology. It says that mod K is actually normal. You can also say that, okay, it is finer than the metric space, right? So it must be normal. But that is, there is a catch there. If something is normal and you have a finer topology, it may not be normal. All right. metric space is for normal, fine. But this what we have put is a binary topology. So you have to carefully here, you have to prove that mod k is normal. It's not like Gauss darkness. Okay. So let us not hand wave here. Let us get a proof of that mod k is normal. What is normality? Given any two disjoint closed sets, they must be, you must be able to separate them by open sets, disjoint open sets. But there are other things. Given any closed subset, okay, if and a continuous function into I, you can extend it to the whole of K, mod K, that will also prove that mod K is normal. So this is the property given by T's extension theorem. If a space has T's extension property, then it must be normal. And conversely, so that is what you must have learned in point set topology. So I am going to use that. So starting with a closed subset A of K, okay, and a continuous function from A to I want to say that there is a continuous function P hat from mod K to I which extends phi. If I prove this, by T's extension theorem, follows that mod K is normal. Okay, there may be different ways of proving this one, but I find this one to be the simplest. So, how to construct phi hat? So again, the recipe, you have already declared how to construct continuous functions on mod K. Construct them on each simplex, each closed simplex, in such a way that on a smaller simplex, whatever you have constructed is extended on the larger simplex. Okay. If a function is constructed like this, then as a function, it makes sense, first of all. Continuity follows because restricted to each mod f, it is continuous. So this is the recipe we are going to follow here. Okay, this will be the first time perhaps we are doing it like this. So what I am going to do is, I will construct a family of functions p indexed with f on mod f to I for each f is simplex, such that if you take A intersection f, this must be the given function phi. Okay, that is the first condition. If it does not intersect, I don't care, it could be anything. Second condition is, if I have already constructed it on f prime, which is subset of f, okay, then the phi f that I am going to construct, restricted to f prime, must be phi f prime. So this is what I say, compatibility. If you have constructed the function on all the vertices, then when you are just extending to, when you are defining it on an edge, you should take care that on the endpoints is already a function that you have constructed. And once all the edges are done, on a triangle when you are defining, it should be on the boundary of this triangle, it should be already the function that you have constructed. Okay. So if you follow that, then you are done. Okay, so inductively you can do this. Namely, take f, suppose you have already defined it on the boundary, which is a lower dimensional simplexes, union of lower dimensional simplexes. If you can extend it over f, you are done. All right, so this is easily done by induction. That's what I am telling you, by f. Since each mod f is normal, okay, because it is a Euclidean space, each mod f is normal, A intersection mod f union all the boundary of mod f, that is a closed subset. On that closed subset, you have a function, continuous function. So apply that mod f is normal, you get an extension on mod f by the same T's extension theorem. put them together, you have the whole function on mod k. Okay. Here are a few remarks and on exercises. I will go through a couple of them. Exercises are for after all exercises. Okay. One of the things that we claimed that mod k as a subset of the product space here, I power v, is a closed subset if v is finite. Okay, you are asked to verify this. Okay, we have defined, actually, if you just read carefully, when v is finite, we have defined a topology in a particular way. Use that to see that it's closed. For any simplicial complex k, this is a typo. I corrected it, but today I am taking the wrong slide here. Mod k cross I, okay, is mod k cross I. This should be triangulate mod k cross I with exactly twice as many vertices as in k, such that k cross 0 and k cross 1 are subcomplexes. Remember, k cross I, this notation was for this prism. So I don't want to use that notation here. K cross I is a simplicial complex, whereas mod k cross I is a topological space. All right. So I want to give you another triangulation of mod k cross I, in which no extra vertices are introduced. Only from k cross 0, all the vertices of k will be there. A copy of that one, k cross 1, again, same thing should be there. Okay. For example, if k is just one edge, then k cross I is the square. So then you are allowed to take only 4 vertices, no more vertices, and triangulate it. And we have shown that there are 2 ways of triangulating it. Either join this diagonal or the other diagonal. There are 2 diagonals there. You can take any one of the diagonal as another extra edge, and you are done. The same thing you should try to do for all simplexes. So that is the exercise here. Okay. But there is no canonicalness here now. And hint is, choose an order on the vertices. Some linear order. Order means that. Okay. That is the hint. Like when you one edge, you have E1, E2. Or E0, E1, whatever. So you have to choose a order and then use that order to write down. That will help. I have given you a triangulation of R. Now you are asked to give a triangulation of Rn. Okay. Do that. Give a triangulation of Pn. Okay. So hint is, use a triangulation, but this is not going to help you much. But it is just a hint, that's all. This is not going to help. Use a triangulation of the spheres and induction. Induction will be correct, but this is not quite the stuff here. Okay, a triangulation will not give you a triangulation of Pn. Here is another concept which I am not very much interested in pursuing, so I have put it in the exercise, namely that k be a simplicial complex, then the 3 conditions here are all equivalent. This is an extra condition mod k, okay? It's not a part of every simplicial complex. The first condition says that each vertex of k belongs to finitely many number of edges. Okay, only finitely many edges will occur there at each vertex. Second condition says that each vertex of K belongs to a finite number of simplexes. Okay, the third one says that the topological aspect mod K is locally compact. Okay, so you see, this is pure combinatorial condition, first two of them. The third one is topological. So you are supposed to prove these three things. Such a thing, if it satisfies any one of them, we call it K to be locally finite. Okay? A locally finite means all that you have to do is look at every vertex. There has to be only finitely many edges emanating from there. Once you immediately locally finite is done, automatically mod K is locally compact. Or conversely, if you have started with a locally compact space, then if you want to triangulate it, okay, you have to choose a K which is locally finite. There is no other choice. Okay, try to prove that. The next one is something about when can a simplicial complex embedded inside Rn? Okay, so it gives you some condition. F from mod K to Rn is a topological embedding. Topological embedding means what? It is continuous function, 1, 1, and on to the image, it's a homeomorphism. If you take the image as a subspace of Rn, then there will be inverse function which is continuous. So that is the meaning of topological embedding. Show that K has to be locally finite. Second is K must be countable. The number of vertices in K must be countable. That is the meaning of countability. Automatically, number of simplexes will be also countable. Okay? The vertex set is countable is the meaning of this. The third thing is dimension of K must be less than or equal to N. So this is harder to prove right now for you. Okay? This is harder. So I have some idea why I have given at this stage. Later on, this will become easier. Okay, after we do a little more theory, dimension of K cannot be bigger than N if it is embedded inside Rn. All right, so I'll continue here. Here it was arbitrary topological embedding. In this exercise, we want F to be linear on each simplex. Rn has a vector space structure. A subset K, namely mod F, that has a linear structure, affine linear structure. So a function F from mod K to F Rn restricted to each mod F, if it's affine linear, then we say F itself is linear. This is just the abuse of notation, abuse of language. Okay? So here I have stated this as a theorem because I have lack of time, I am not going to treat this one. So by following a number of exercises, you can complete the proof of this theorem. Namely, every locally finite countable simplicial complex of dimension K. So all these conditions were there in the earlier exercise. If there is an embedding. Now I am reversing. In the converse, I have put dimension of K to be very small. Namely, it is less than half, you see. Then we can have a linear embedding F from mod K to R to K plus 1. Okay. So what is the idea? Idea behind it is there in these steps. All right, so these are steps A, B, C, D. So let me stop here. You can read them by yourself. थैंक यू.